Hey everyone, welcome back to the Scrounged Engineering Chronicles, and welcome back to part two of the build of our plywood hauling rack. We covered most of the construction of the pieces last time around. This time around we'll cover final assembly and building and attaching the legs and so on. The tricky part is going to be attaching these PVC rails, so watch closely in that portion of the video. If you have any questions, leave them down below. Hopefully the camera work will be a little bit better this time around, and I think I didn't cut my head off completely. If you don't care about the finish on the plywood rack, the hauling rack, you don't have to paint it. I would recommend slapping on a coat of lacquer or polyurethane just for some basic protection, but again, this is something that if you're not too fussy about the finish, you can easily complete it in a weekend. And even if you have to buy everything from scratch from your home center, you're looking at less than $50 in materials. So let's get to it. Let's go ahead and get some glue on these. Just using 1 1/4 inch deck screws, which I proceed to throw all over the floor. Time to set that one aside, and work on the next one. Okay, there's one very, very important thing that you have to do when you're laying out these laterals. If you want the feet to be spaced equally when the whole thing's unfolded and then sitting flat in the bed of your truck, you have to bear in mind that those end pieces are offset by a sequence of 2 inches in terms of length. Going from this side arbitrarily, the first one sticks out 4, the middle one sticks out 6, and the last one sticks out 8. You know what? Scratch this. It'll be easier to show you. Here in the drawing, this is an overhead view of the rack, and you can see each of the 3 lengthwise rails, and the red rectangles are where the feet get mounted onto those lengthwise rails. At the left side of the drawing is an example of one end or cross piece with the 4-inch, the 6-inch, and the 8-inch stub mounted to it. Hopefully this layout will explain why I'm offsetting everything as you travel across the 3 legs. If you look at the topmost lengthwise rail here, you can see that the first foot is inset 2 inches and the middle foot is inset 38 inches. I've chosen to inset the rightmost foot on this rail in 6 inches from the right edge, just because it's easier to measure from there. And as you progress down the drawing, or the center lengthwise rail and the bottom, you can see I'm actually shifting the dimensions of the foot placement. And as you go from top to bottom down through these lengthwise rails, you can see that the dimensions shift by 2 inches. The reason for this is obvious. If you look at the left side of the drawing where that example cross piece is drawn in, this gives you the 2-inch offset between rails when the mechanism folds flat. This is to allow it to fold flat and not get bound up or interfere with itself. In order to keep all of the feet in line, that's the reason for the 2-inch
shift in position. Now, these dimensions are a little bit arbitrary. I chose them because I wanted the feet basically equidistant all the way across. The other reason I chose these dimensions was so that this rack, when placed in the bed of my truck, does not interfere with the main canoe lumber hauling rack that I built in the prior video.
Righto, I've got all three of the longitudinal pieces done in that the feet are mounted. The only remaining step besides painting is cutting the PVC pipe, which we will do in the next segment. That's what you should get, and you should get a nice even cutout if you haven't rotated it too much. Look, it's Christmas time in April. Here's just a quick close-up look at the jig I put together for the table saw to cut the slot in that PVC pipe. It's just a standard featherboard, and I've got a video further back in my channel. I'll put a link that'll take you back to making featherboards and these homemade knobs. And then this is just a scrap hunk of 2x4 that in the early part of the setup, you saw how I set it on there to get the height, and I just rounded the front edge here on the disc sander so the piping would feed under there smoothly. But yeah, boy, that stuff makes a mess. It leaves a fine powder. So if you're going to be cutting very much of that, I strongly recommend you wear a face mask, especially if you can't cut outside. If you've got to cut it indoors in a basement or something, don't breathe that junk. That is fine plastic powder. Could probably wreak havoc in your lungs, so just be cautious. But yeah, just using my alignment mark, all I did was run it through for the first cut and keep my rough alignment mark on the pipe here, and then for the second pass I rotated it over so there was I just eyeballed it really, about a quarter of an inch lateral distance, and then I just ran it through and kept that distance eyeballed as I fed the pipe through, and that cut the slit that I needed. And you don't have to run your blade up very far. As you can see, I don't know if you can see down in there, I think I turned it up 4 cranks on mine. I probably could have gotten away with 2.5 or 3 cranks, but doesn't take much. And the stuff cuts pretty easily, but make sure you got your featherboard tight and you got this tight, because you don't want it kicking and walking around on you. That's all there was to it. Okay, once you've got your pieces cut and trimmed, you're ready to slide them on into the little grooves that we milled. You may need to use a persuader stick. Just get started. Once it's in the groove, it shouldn't be too bad though. Of course I might have lied, so that's why you have a persuader hammer. There we go. And that's pretty much it. Just go ahead and tap it on the rest of the way. Oh, I gotta clean up this pigsty. It's driving me crazy. Let's try a little gravity here. Really cut the slot just a little bit narrow. Let's try the dead blow here. Looks like it's fitting down in the groove just fine. It's just going to be snug, which is kind of what you want, really. You don't want this coming loose. But that was the purpose of milling those 2 slots. I will say this, once you get it on, it isn't coming off, so make sure you've got everything set where you want it. Holy mackerel. Whew. Okay, we'll keep beating on it. Let me fast forward through this so you don't have to suffer through it too. I'm gonna have to work out some kind of lubricant for that. See if I can make it a little bit easier. And so we keep hammering on the second one. Okay, so I've got the first of the long rails braced against the back of the bed of the truck there. One of the things I'm going to try here is to wax up that grit, that groove. I'm just going to use some paste wax and get a little dab of it on there. Starting at the top of the groove, right, just kind of run it and run the gob down the groove. Hopefully that'll make it a little bit easier to pound this thing on. We'll give that a try and see. Holy crap. My arm's about to fall off. But I got it on there after about 20 minutes of beating. I don't recommend doing that for the long rails. It works okay for the short rails. I'm just trying to find a better method to where I can start it on one end here and kind of roll it on and then tap it down around. I think it'll go much, much quicker. So that's what I'm going to try on the next two. But my arms are falling off my shoulders and I'm very, very thirsty. Okay, here's what I've come up with. I have clamped the long rail piece to my workbench via clamping it to a toolbox so it's held upright. I've put in these 2 little L brackets on either side and jammed those up into the slot. Now I'm just using a 3rd clamp to slowly lever that down into place And once that starts to spread, then I'm just going to go along and tap it all the way down. So let's give that a try. Okay. That method seems to actually work. The trick is you get it started, and then you just got to kind of pop it out a little bit with a screwdriver. Tap it down a bit. Sort of tap it down as you go. This was working much better earlier when I wasn't filming it. Go figure. You'll hear that kind of crack or pop. That's when it slides down the rest of the way. And that is now seated on there, nice and tight. And basically, it is never, ever, ever coming off. So make sure you've got it where you want it as you're doing this. And that's why you want to cut the groove undersized a bit. You can see how the corner here kind of grabs into the slot a little bit. That's what you're shooting for, is you want that those two edges to sort of bite down in there. Let me set this up and I'll show you here. 7/8 of an inch. So as long as you follow those measurements, this will work out just fine. The real trick, like I tried to show you earlier, is getting that gap milled straight. And that's where having a table saw. You really almost have to have a table saw in order to do that. That worked much better. Instead of 25 minutes and my arms being sore, that was about 4 or 5 minutes gently tapping and getting it in there. So let me swap this out and go ahead and do the third rail, and then I can put this together. So maybe another half hour, we'll be done. Let's go ahead. All right, just enough to hold it in place. Doesn't have to be crazy. Is to get it started, use a clamp. You have to have continuous pressure. Pound it on there, doesn't work, it just bounces. Use some continuous pressure. Use a little bit of tape on the other end to try to hold it. But once you get it started, okay, and I'm going to use the clamp to force it down. Started. It gets a lot easier. Here's a technique I found to be effective. If you've got some putty knives or spackling knives, right? Put one on one side in the groove, one on the other side in the groove. The wider, the better. So you take your two putty knives, you wedge one in the groove this way, one in the groove on the other side, and just give them. And tap it down in, and then just work your way along, wedging one putty knife after another. It may seem like a bit of work, but trust me, it's a hell of a lot easier than trying to knock this thing down lengthways the way I did on that first one. Grab them, squeeze them, and then give it a whack, and you'll hear it crack and pop where it seats in on the groove. Really, that's just it. Keep working your way down. Pretty good. That is 3 for 3. So let me throw the hinges in and I will be ready to put this together. Okay. Oh, I gotta clean this place up. I got crap everywhere. When you install these, the way you want to put them in there is the hinge goes rigid, right? The other thing you want to do, since this is the top side, make sure the top of the pin is on the top side. You know, you want gravity working in your favor. So, and that is that. Pre-wax the screws. Line it up so that the hinge tightens up this way. And go ahead and drive them in. Right, so we're ready for final assembly. I've got all the pieces laid out here, and what we're going to be doing now is trying to jigger this all together. So I'm going to set up the tripod and work my way down, and then I'm going to flip it around and attach the other end. And voila, here is the rack. Let me shuffle that around a little bit, and then I'll show you how easy it is to get sheet goods on and off this thing. You can see this is much, much easier to load than trying to splay it off to the side or put it down in over top of the tailgate and miss the wheel humps and so on. You've got plenty of clearance on the wheel wells and room underneath here. So if you need to throw some additional stuff, you're good. The other thing this does is it gets it up to where you can put a tie-down strap around here and then run it to the far corners of the truck bed so it'll keep it from sliding back. But it also makes unloading after you're done much, much easier.
Even on out.
So that's it. The second hauling rack for my pickup truck is done. And this is very, very strong. Pretty much you can load this up to the capacity of your truck, which you do have to be careful of, particularly because you're going to be supporting a fair bit of weight out here on the tailgate itself. So bear that in mind. I would certainly not, on my little truck, I'm never going to haul more than, I don't know, maybe 3 or 4 sheets of MDF at most, because I don't want to risk overloading it. I have overloaded this thing in the past, and it's not a comfortable ride. Let me show you how it folds up here and stores away.
Like a ladder hook rack.
Just pivots together along the hinge lines, and it's still pretty stable like that. well worth it. And in my case, other than the pipe, the PVC pipe, everything was scrounged. So I'm out a grand total of $10. And I now have a way to haul sheet goods and load them and unload them much more easily. Hi, welcome back. We're all done with the plywood or sheet goods hauling rack. Let me go ahead and load it up. It only takes a second. And that is it. Loading sheet goods is very easy with this thing. Like I showed you, just running a sheet of plywood up onto that is a piece of cake. It folds nice and flat. It is a little bit long to try to store. So what I'm going to end up doing is I've got some essentially wall hooks that I'm making that I'm going to mount into the studs on that wall. And I'm going to hang my ladders horizontally, but then that gives me room. I'll put a second set underneath, but I'm going to hang the sheet goods rack probably on that same set of hooks as that longer ladder. The nice thing about this design, and maybe I'll give you a quick look, the project prior to this where I built the canoe hauling rack, I designed this to be able to fit in around it so I can have both in there at the same time. And there you have the whole enchilada. Canoe rack or ladder rack or hauling rack for lumber and piping. Up top, everything rolls very, very smoothly on and off thanks to the PVC pipe. You got your sheet goods rack so you can slide in sheets of plywood. And the beauty of this is with the width of the bed of the truck, a 48 inch piece of plywood has about an inch of room on each side. So it'll slide all the way up on this to the front of the bed of the truck. Then all you gotta do is tie your stuff down and you are good to go. So thanks for watching, and I hope you've enjoyed the projects. I've got a whole bunch more coming. Keep scrounging. Please stay safe, and I'll catch you next time. Again, as with most of my projects, this thing is made from primarily scrap, scrounged, found, and trash pick materials. And I'm going to have to take this again because there's another f***ing car. No, you don't care about that. I'm doing it again. Blech. This is why you really need to clean your shop. Oh, I gotta clean this place up. It helps if you have the wrench going in the right direction. That'll go in the outtakes. Nobody's nerfed, right? Yeah, sure. Knock it on the floor. There it is. Frickin' thing. Ah! Okay. Take 7. Get that in secured. Because it's so much fun! I'm so glad I picked this project. Oy. A pain in my ass. Pain in the ass. Okay.